Hello everyone, welcome back to Seeker Plus and our series on supersonic transports, or SSTs, commercial jets that would let anyone who could afford it to travel faster than the speed of sound. I'm your host, Julian Huguet, and man, am I really enjoying this topic. The first episode was all about why the speed of sound was so important for airplanes, and the second went into the history of these amazing jets with some truly bizarre stories about broken bones and Soviet spies and NBA teams. Definitely check those two out if you haven't already, especially if you want some more context for what we're going to be talking about here today, the future of SSTs. NASA and a handful of private startups are exploring making supersonic travel a reality for more than just hotshot fighter pilots who love high fives and beach volleyball. One company, Spike Aerospace, is developing a jet that the vast majority of us will still never get to buckle into. They're focused on making small private planes aimed at wealthy business executives. Another startup called Boom has a very different strategy. They're developing a jet called the Overture that's eerily reminiscent of the only commercially successful SST to date, the Concorde. Boom's stated goal is to eventually offer flights anywhere in the world in under 4 hours for as little as $100 a ticket. That is a really bold statement, especially considering that the company's test jet has yet to fly. And they're working with the same company that made Concorde's engines, Rolls-Royce, but they still don't have an engine yet. Some big airlines have shown interest. United ordered 15 Overtures, but as the makers of Concorde will tell you, just because an airline has placed an order doesn't mean they won't change their mind and cancel later. Private companies like Spike and Boom believe they'll succeed where others failed because of advances in computer-aided design and new materials that didn't exist 60 years ago. But it's not easy. One other major leader, Aerion, abruptly closed up shop in 2021, despite having $11 billion worth of orders lined up. Even if these designs can get off the ground, there's still another problem they'll have to overcome. Civil supersonic flights over the US are still banned because of that inescapable consequence of the physics of sound, the sonic boom. In the last few years, though, engineers have been searching for a way to turn down the boom's volume. Maybe, if it's quiet enough, people on the ground won't mind it or even notice it, and the FAA might lift its ban. That would open up transcontinental or long-haul routes for SSTs, making them viable to buy and operate in bigger numbers and drive down overall costs. One of the most promising hopes for quieter, faster-than-sound travel is being developed by NASA in collaboration with Lockheed Martin. The two entities have been hard at work on an airplane known as the X-59 Quest, or Quiet Supersonic Technology. It's finally taking shape, and what a totally bizarre shape it is. It's nearly 30 meters long, but much of its size comes from its enormous nose, not unlike myself. Seriously though, this thing is long. Proboscis is really more of a fitting term. Once you get over the nose, and it'll take a while, you'll notice the X-59 doesn't have a windscreen. There's no front window for the pilot to see out of. Don't worry though, they're not going to fly with their head out the window like Ace Ventura. Instead, the pilot has a computer monitor in front of them, which will be fed live images from external cameras. The wings are also oddly curved like a gull's wings, and the engine piggybacks on the fuselage with the intake behind the cockpit. All of these design choices were made with the help of advanced computer simulations in order to shape the shockwaves. Typical supersonic jets have features like prominent bubble-shaped glass canopies, which are great for visibility that a pilot might need in an intense dogfight. But they also create shockwaves that coalesce and make a sonic boom louder. The long nose and gentle curves of the X-59 were designed to keep those shockwaves to a minimum, so the sonic boom sounds more like a thump. It's also optimized to fly much higher than today's commercial jets, so the energy from the shockwaves can dissipate more by the time it reaches the ground. While Concorde's boom had a perceived decibel level of 105, the X-59 is aiming for just 75. That's about 1/8 the noise, or as NASA says, about as loud as a car door closing. The X-59 is still in its final stages of assembly, and should be ready to take flight in 2022. Once Lockheed Martin confirms that the airplane actually, flies, NASA will begin acoustic testing. Another supersonic jet will fly around the X-59 to measure the shockwaves it produces. NASA will also take pictures of the shockwaves, what's known as Schlieren photography. To do this, the X-59 will have to fly perfectly between a camera and the sun. Now, it's not easy, but they have done it in the past with older jets and come up with some really breathtaking images. It's also kind of funny to think that more than a century after Ernst Mach made breakthroughs in the physics of shockwaves with photos of speeding bullets, we're still doing something that's not that different in principle. If you want to know more about him and why sound is so important for airplanes, by the way, be sure to watch episode 1 of this series. I'll put a link in the description. At the ground level, NASA will also gather data from microphones to empirically measure just how quiet their quiet SST really is. Even if it reaches NASA's loudness goal, they'll still have to hear from the public. The final phase of testing will involve flying over big cities and rural areas to gauge people's reaction, and I can just hear the people of Oklahoma City now saying, "Not again!" Once they've collected all this data, NASA will present their findings to regulators, and then who knows what could happen? The ban on supersonic commercial flights could get lifted, and SSTs might make a triumphant return for good. The director of Lockheed's X-59 project thinks that that could happen as soon as 2035 if all goes well. Maybe then I'll finally live out my childhood dream of traveling faster than sound. Or maybe the ban will stay in place. Or maybe the FAA will allow it, but environmental agencies like the EPA will deem that emissions from supersonic flights aren't acceptable. Or maybe we'll develop carbon-neutral jet fuel that's cheap enough to make thirsty SSTs economically viable. Or maybe in an era of high-speed internet, there won't be a high demand for speedy international flights because fancy business execs will opt for video conferencing instead. Maybe they'd rather just meet up in the metaverse if that actually happens. I don't know. The future of supersonic commercial flight is up in the air. We may once again leap ahead in speed, or the age of Concorde might be a 3-decade boom time that we've left behind for good. It could all depend on the X-59 quest, and if people across America are bothered by a mysterious double thump in the near future, or if they even notice it at all. Hey, thanks for tuning into this episode of Seeker Plus. If you liked it, or if you have ideas for future shows, be sure to drop us a line. You can reach out to us in the comments or on Twitter at Seeker. And if you happen to have an F-16 with an open back seat and want to make the dreams of my bucktooth inner child come true, you can find me on Twitter as well. I'm at HugItOut. That's all for now. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you on the next Seeker Plus.